Excellent. So this morning we are coming to a very exciting seminar. Thank you all for coming. We really appreciate it. Please invite your friends as well. This morning, so we actually have a treat. We have a presentation by Dr. Osman Alhassan, who is going to talk to us about exploring the links between economic visibility and social vulnerability, the case of women's rotating credit associations in the Yendi Municipality. And so this certainly is going to be an exciting presentation, not just because it talks about women and agency, but also because it talks about rotating credit. And microcredit has been in the news recently when there's been some microcredit organizations who have sort of scammed a large percentage of Ghanaians. And I'm sure we remember that even some of those folks have complained about not being able to pay school fees. And in some situations, some have also even committed suicide as a result of the scam. So while he's not going to talk about that, there's certainly a lot of press and information about rotating credit and its impact in the community. So this is going to specifically speak about the impact of rotating credit and microcredit on women. So this is exciting. And then in order to chair this wonderful presentation, we have Dr. Irene Apeng-Addo, who is our former seminar coordinator. So we're sort of tag teaming, it seems like. And so she's going to walk us through the abstract as well as his bio. And then, of course, we'll take questions after that. Thank you so much. And I'm turning it over to Dr. Irene.
Thank you very much, Dr. Freywart. We are so grateful. And then thank you all for making time to be here. Let me just give a little bit biography about Dr. Osman. So Dr. Osman Alhassan is a senior research fellow with the Institute of African Studies, associated with the Societies and Cultures section. He is also a senior interfaculty member of the Center for Migration Studies at the University of Ghana. He holds a PhD in human geography from the University of Ghana, and his research spans over 16 years. He has published extensively on land access and tenure security in Ghana, urban environmental health and integrated disaster risk reduction, vulnerability analysis and community resilience building, water resource management strategies in Ghana, and recently in menstrual hygiene management. He is currently a member of the PeriPeriU Consortium, which is a team of researchers from 11 African universities working to increase capacities in African universities for understanding climate variability and risk reduction efforts in Africa. He co-edited a book on environmental health, disaster risk, livelihoods and ecology in the Kolil Lagoon complex in Accra, Ghana, which was published in 2014. He is also a member of the editorial committee for the Contemporary Journal of African Studies, which is published by the Institute of African Studies of the University of Ghana. Just to mention two of his recent publications. The first one is a book, both of them are book chapters. So the first one is entitled Ecological Social Work in a Developing Nation, Africa, which he is a co-author with other researchers. And it's published in an edited book titled Ecological Social Work Towards Sustainability. The editors for that book is Jennifer McNeon and then Margaret Alston. And this book was published in 2016. Then in 2015, he and his co-authors also contributed another chapter in a book titled Cities at Risk, Planning for and Recovering from Natural Disasters, which was edited by Pierre Filon, Gary Sands, and Mark Skidmore. The title of their chapter is entitled Enhancing Hazard Resilience Among Impoverished Urban Communities in Ghana, the Role of Women as Catalyst for Improvement. So you can see from his recent research that he has done a lot of work associated with women and gender in general. So this morning we are privileged to have him present or share some of his research titled Exploring the Links Between Economic Visibility and Social Vulnerability, the case of Women's Rotating Credit Association in the Yendi Municipality. His research will examine the role of women's access to rotating credit and its impact on the livelihoods of women and households in the Yendi Municipality. In his representation, he hopes to demonstrate that though there are positive economic and social gains associated with this kind of credit towards poverty reduction and improvement of living standards at the household level, there are still some unintended negative outcomes for women and children in the municipality. He hopes to highlight the militating effect of tradition and culture in reinforcing these negative outcomes of women's successes with regards to their community visibility. So on that note, I hand over to our presenter, Dr. Osman Alhassan.
Thank you, Irene, for the very kind words, and thanks everybody for being here. I'm not offering apologies, but in the event you see me shuffling between the screen and the papers, I had some small emergency the past days, and my presentation I couldn't just locate it. But that's also what we do in crisis management. So I'm here with my colleagues and my students. And also, beyond just interacting with you, I would also use this platform to see how I can manage crisis when they occur. So, but thanks very much. Let me say that the most of this work actually is connected with risks and disasters. And what we've been doing is to look at some kind of exposures that people would have, but especially women, in terms of trying to make livelihoods within a context where we still have some kind of social norms and traditions that in a way, you know, they are interpreted differently, even though I've called it vulnerability, but in a way they can be looked of as positives also. But then when we finish the discussion, I'm sure the discussion would be open and we would all see. So basically we're just trying to look at how microcredit, and at the very basic level, there are many kinds of them. The emphasis is more on, you know, the rotating, you know, credit associations that the women in Yemen, normally in very small groups, and we see how it influences their livelihood activities and the impacts that it has on the household. But basically, in these days, I see the literature mentions it more like microfinance. Everybody is taking to microfinance rather than even microcredit. And, you know, but it's all still the same. And basically what it simply means is trying to extend small loans, very small actually. Loans sometimes to the tune of 100 cedis, you know, there are still rural banks in the north, you know, who would get cooperatives, 20, 30 people, sometimes up to 50, and they give them some 200 to 300 cedis the whole time, you know, farming season to go do something with it. And I tell you, majority will tell you that it's really something. So we're talking of very small monies that would go around, you know, and it allows people to be able to take care of themselves and their families. And I'm sure if you know our poverty profile in Ghana, you shouldn't be very surprised when you are told what 100 cedis can do for people who are in some, you know, desperate situation. I don't exactly know what the current, you know, handout is with respect to the LEAP, the Livelihood Empowerment Against Poverty, but it's as small as about, you know, 80 cedis in 3 months for a family that is up to four, you know. Yeah, and that is something enough to keep people alive. So having said this, it's just to highlight that it's very important. The monies might be very small. And so also we know that in the era, or even before, you know, poverty reduction became, you know, the very basic project in sustainable development, both governments and NGOs used to provide, you know, small credits to people to enhance their earning capacities. That is for them to do whatever livelihood activities that they do and then be able to take care of basic things. And most importantly, we know that these loans are not only small in size, but the frequency may just be once, you know, in a while, if it's coming from the government or local government or an organized credit association. But it is also convenient because it is at the community level and it's based on local conditions. And what I'm just saying is that if we were giving credit to agricultural, you know, people engaged in agricultural activities, as small as it is, but you would let it coincide with the farming season, with the time that they want the inputs, or with the time that they want, you know, some money to do work. And just placing in context to, basically, the UN General Assembly years ago had even adopted, you know, the resolution, and it is within the working documents of the UNFAO, because it deals with farmers and it deals with small groups. And the instance was that microcredit should be a basic tool which should be facilitated so that you reach many people to be able to enhance productivity and then make many families be able to, you know, take care of themselves. But even before the UN declaration, you know, there was a summit on social development held in Copenhagen. And the essence was that there are so many rural and urban producers who really would wish to be able to be engaged in the productive front, but are often challenged by the amounts of money they have or do not have. And so the issue also is that if you want to advance human progress, then we need to take care, or governments need to take care of disadvantaged and vulnerable groups. And so all this is a way of looking at how we have come. I mentioned the livelihood empowerment against poverty. That is like an extreme case where you're looking at families who cannot make it at some level. So if you take Ghana's poverty line, it means those beneficiaries fall below that. But I'm just stressing that beyond this, there are even ordinary, active, you know, households where individuals do not have avenues to start up a business. And so that is where we find the relevance of microcredit. And particularly I'm mentioning this the report was released actually in 2014, but it is from 1991 to 2012, where the World Bank actually said Ghana had made a lot of, you know, progress in reducing poverty. And poverty reduction has been in the literature. There are many debates, but I think it's generally accepted that if even you were to dole out just some money for a family to have a meal, you know, and not sleep without food in their stomachs, you are in a way reducing poverty. But the programs do more than that, even though the project-based nature of it doesn't do much. So we're just looking at it, that Ghana has a development agenda. We currently have the Ghana Shared Growth and, you know, and Development Agenda, and the essence is for the government to be able to make, you know, development available to many people. And you can only do that by ensuring that individuals are productive in their own right. And especially, so far I haven't mentioned, but we know the position that women, you know, occupy in our society. And with all the kind of social changes that we think is happening, and all the development laurels that we've been accorded, we know that there are still communities, including Yendi Municipality, where I come from, where you still have typically traditional societies, and sometimes you wonder whether development has really penetrated, you know, into some communities. So basically, just to wind up with this, it's about the size of the loans that makes it micro. It's about the target users. It's about utilization. It's for specific things. And the conditions are flexible, but sometimes can be tough depending on who it is. As I said, we are concerned with rotating credit. In the literature, I've seen, I asked my Nigerian colleague, Susu, actually. In Ghana, we call it Susu. But in a lot of the UN literature, it's like it exists in Ghana, Liberia, Nigeria, Cameroon, you know, and they use the word esusu, you know, they add E, you know, which means that it's a general thing within, you know, the West African continent. And simply, it is rotating amongst women generally. And what happens is that people would agree to pay or to make some savings. And in this case, they would get, in Yendi, they get a trusted one amongst them. But in one of the groups that I interviewed, they have an older lady who they have their trust in. So depending on, it is a regular thing, so they may decide that, oh, after every market day, we would be able to contribute this. But depending on how the system works, you would then decide on a rotation basis. So everybody pulls maybe 10 CDs apiece, and if you are 20 members, you would then be able to raise 200 Ghana CDs. That would be money enough, I'm not saying enough, but within the local context, that is enough for somebody who would have struggled for maybe months to be able to get that. They would begin to use it to do work, and then would try to pay when the time is due for others. So basically, it's just like, you know, pooling together the resources on some regular basis, on a predetermined amount, and then also loosely they have, you know, transactions, or they have, you know, implied ways by which you can sanction somebody who would not pay. So basically, the objective of this is just to understand women's involvement in rotating credit associations. Document the kind of positive outcomes, include economic visibility, understand the changing roles of women's contributions, that's before and after their visibility, and then the nature of vulnerabilities women face and how they manage the situations. I must say actually that, like Irene gave the introduction, we're doing this vulnerability things within a broader spectrum of how communities, individuals, and groups are likely to respond when they have a shock or a stress. I mean, ordinarily, people might already be suffering, but vulnerability is actually measured when a community or an individual has a shock, you know, a stressor, an event which you never anticipated. So within the general scheme of things, we've been working to see how, when disasters strike, And the thinking had long been that, you know, natural hazards are very perilous in themselves. And while you and I would agree that if a rainstorm comes with some speed in terms of wind with some water, it's likely to devastate some buildings than others. But we also know that the kind of havoc caused would depend on the environment. Yeah, so a building like this is likely to withstand a rainstorm than many other living or work environments you get in many parts of Accra. No, so that is the context. The context that, you know, it is not too much the natural hazard or the risk that you face, but it depends on your condition. And so vulnerability is not just a one-way thing. It's built over time, but it could also be instant. So that is why this one seeks to achieve. This one is a bit tailored towards the social dimension. And so I wouldn't go much into the physical dimensions of disaster, of risk, and then of resilience. Now, a bit about the study area. Yendi is the municipality recorded 118,000 in the last population census. And just like in Accra, I remember many people telling me that they weren't counted. So you can imagine what it would be like. You know, so it's a big town, but it's also a big village because it doesn't have much infrastructure. If you look at the analysis that is coming from the, you know, Ghana Statistical Service, 214 publications on the district profiles, it has a lot of, you know, problems. Sanitation problems, its school and health facilities are overstretched in terms of, you know, the demand and the supply. You know, people there, and last year, I don't know how many of you know, water situation was so bad because the river Dakar that they draw their water sources from got dry, you know, and so they had to send emergency relief, water, drinking water and others from Tamale and surrounding areas. So generally, many people in Yendi are unemployed or underemployed, even as the majority of them also rely on agriculture. And because it is also in the savanna ecology, it adds another dimension. And I need to stress this. The importance of, or the significance of what I'm trying to do was just the fact that day in, day out, we know that development is advancing. And we know that there are some improvements, including the dictates of what we find in reports and the World Bank report I just mentioned. But we also know that, you know, the development is that we have is not shared by everybody. There are a lot of people who and communities who are not part of the development that we see. So just like I mentioned from the beginning, my presentation got truncated, and from now I would go to the field notes to try to explain what the understanding is about social economic visibility and social vulnerability. Well, so with microcredit, the women get to be able to raise some amount of money which you wouldn't have been able to do if you were alone. So if you are in a group of seven, all the way, the largest group that we ever interviewed, I interviewed about four groups. The largest group was about 24, and they said it was difficult to manage, especially when everybody is not responding to the routines. And so they normally would want it in smaller groups. So the average size is about 10 to 12 people. And what they normally would do then is that, you know, they would contribute for one person, and the person takes the money. There are quite a number of them. There were petty traders. There were those who would trade in foodstuffs. So they would go distances to be able to bring the foodstuffs. And then there were also those who were what I classified as food vendors, you know, food and water vendors. In all these domains, they have groups, and they would contribute and would decide on how it goes in those rotation. And so in our interviews and in the observations, we did ask what progress they thought they made differently from women who were not in it. And the reality actually is that you hardly would get any active woman in the Yendi municipality and Yendi township itself who hasn't ventured at one time or the other by joining a rotating credit association. But along the line, they fall out. We would see that part of it as a result of the vulnerabilities that we talked of. So in a way, because it's so difficult for people to mobilize some resources to start a business, it is the main source by which majority of women and most of them married would be able to raise some money and do something, get some extra to feed their kids, pay school fees, and then attend to some other medical contingencies. So in a way, the other opinion leaders that I interviewed, teachers, some imams, you know, and even some husbands, were of the view that yes, taken in general, even with the vulnerability, you can see that some of the women who subscribe to being part of the rotating credit associations are able to make some money. And that within the society, they are economically visible more than others who might not be doing the business as regularly as they would or may be able to do it on continuous basis. So the general understanding is that it affords women the opportunity to get some money to trade, and it allows them to be able to make something from it to solve household issues. We will not go too much into whose responsibility it is in the household, but I guess in that traditional society, men still are seen as responsible for providing for the household needs. Unfortunately, many men are unable to provide for. And so the women have long stepped in their shoes and they are bearing the brunt. And so depending on what the husband is doing and or what other family members would be able to support, women are at the forefront trying to, you know, turn over, use this capital, turn it over and be able to make a difference. So the general understanding is that there is some kind of economic visibility. Now, practically, what does that mean? You know, and what it simply means is that in the interviews beyond those who subscribe to microcredit, I mean, they are more likely to be contributing. They are asked to pay more money when there are social events because they seem to have a bit more, you know, cash than the others. A number of them, and this is voluntary, a number of them are able to, you know, once a while, not only give themselves or buy themselves good clothing, but other family members, including husbands. And in my sample, actually, I had quite a good number of husbands who said that, you know, their wives support them in a way. I don't know whether that was window dressing, but I believe it's not so. Because even as men are unable to do what they're supposed to do in terms of family obligations, it is still a traditional society. And in Yendi, many people would not want, many men don't take it kindly, you know, when you imply that their wives support them economically. So unless it was very true, they wouldn't say that. You know, that's one thing. And then also, we interacted with some health workers and some teachers, and occasionally they've seen that it's the women, the mothers who would follow the kids to school when they send them home. When the government gave the capitation grant and gave the, you know, well, school feeding, it's not all schools that have it, but the capitation grant, many people interpreted it, and today even in Yendi, you know, they interpreted it as covering everything. And so sometimes in class, the teachers say they would send home a pupil because they think that they should at least get some pencil or eraser and exercise book, you know, to do something. And it's normally the mothers who would follow up and be able to provide for such things. At the health service, you know, especially the mutual health insurance scheme, you know, we had a discussion with three health workers. They also had experience with mothers who come with their kids and along the line would explain that, you know, I have to send them to school too and inform the school teacher why they are not around. So basically, not only is the evidence from women who are involved in these credit associations that they do this kind of things, but there are collaborative, you know, there is collaboration from the other side that they really are doing better. And then we had a small interaction with schoolgirls and some youngsters, and it turned out that there was a pattern in terms of those who were a bit successful using the microcredit resources. And the girls and some women looked at them as role models, you know. They would want to be able to behave the way they are. They would want to be able to be as industrious as they are and still also be able to be seen. And basically also that is it. Social visibility generally is not just what the individual would think of him or herself. It's more about what the community thinks you are. And there are ways that the community shows that, you know, you are visible, because then it means that you are respected in some light, you are likely to be more consulted on some other things. So the economic visibility here was just looking at the way with the resources that they have, they turn something around and they are able to make some contributions to society voluntarily, which is recognized as successes to some extent. So basically, you know, that is the issue about the, you know, economic visibility that we found. There are other instances related to, for example, where people still live in extended family homes. They are crowded, and a few of the women are able to, you know, help their husbands buy a piece of land, and then they check out from, you know, the communal house. They will still go there for meetings and still interact and do everything as the extended family would do, but they would form their own nuclear but extended family. Nuclear but extended because hardly, you know, the very moment you seem to take leave and you want to live separately, then you have more space, you are doing better, and so the load comes to you, you know, back life. So literally it's difficult to see how it works, but it does. If you want to see it as a process, you know, it does transform that way. And then in Yendi, it's difficult to just tell, but the main political parties, the NPP and the NDC, you know, have their women magazines who are there, and you know, they are high profile people. Some of them got that way because they were already visible in society. And there are quite a number of them who today are at the forefront of trying to see how women can get extra resources beyond their own contributions, because it is true that some of them were able to break some few barriers and be noticed, you know. And today they are actually going higher and they are able to do organization for parties and have more resources at their disposal. I did ask at some point in time when we were interacting with an assemblywoman and one of the party functionaries who's a female, and it was all like laughter, because one of the group discussions, they said, well, they help us, but not very often. We might have to wait until political activities are at its height. Then maybe, you know, we can get, you know, wealth redistributed. I get the feeling that we might all just say it loosely, but it's true that sometimes during political activities, there's quite some amount of resources and that they would be able to leverage to the communities. So that is basically about social economic visibility. And those conversant with well, not only the north, I mean, smaller cities. You know how the motorbike is ridden in Tamale, Yendi, and others, you know. Yeah, it's a treasure thing. So the very day people throw away their, you know, second-hand Korean bicycles, you know, and they go for even a used Mapuka, you know, then you are seen to be doing well, and rightly so, because even in Yendi, they cross the border, they buy it from Togo, especially the used ones, and new ones as well. And currently, ladies, I was told that the ladies in Tamale have actually sent the prices skyrocketing. So now you get a very good Mapuka new one at 5,000, when even which is the type the Napanduri Terror was using, you know, which is more solid. You get that even at 3,000. But the point I'm just making is that they get home use motorcycles at between 600 to 1,500. And you've got to be resourceful to be able to have that. And I was told in the interviews, in an interview with one imam, that, oh, they're doing well. Can't you see these days there are many of the ladies riding the motorcycles than men, you know? And he told me, I know a lot of women, they bought motorcycles for their husbands. Now, it's difficult to say that because they were dealing in microcredit, but obviously, if it is also the fact that it's difficult to get resources, and that is what has helped them, and some of them still sustain it, then you can see that it happens. And the field evidence is they themselves say that they get some economic visibility because of belonging to the rotating credit associations. Otherwise, it would have been difficult to get initial capital to start off something. Okay, so that is it. But unintended outcomes. And now we're talking of social vulnerability. With all those economic progress that are painted, especially with women, and I'm not sure I'm implying that we should understand it that it's rosy for women in Yendi and that they might be doing better than men. This is just a small proportion of the women folks, so it will be difficult to make that generalization. But a serious effect then is that, and maybe it's also part of social organization and social change, the very moment these women seem to be making progress and they seem to be economically visible, then they have more than proportionate pressures, you know, on them to do one or two things. And so the first instance is that they are forced to bear burdens. That's what we're talking of. And because of the kind of environment they live in, they are exposed to whatever pressures that they have to take. So, for example, you are in an extended family home where you can still see, they still have the grandfather or the grandmother living. Then they have the mother and father, and then they have aunties and uncles, you know. And I'm sure you know what the compound house looks like, you know. So you have small households, not completely independent, but it is a big extended family. And so you have all these pressures because some others are unable maybe to get money just to buy food. Others would ask them for money to be able to buy some clothes. Like I said, even the women involved in this and doing better, they voluntarily would give some money when it's an outdooring, when it's a marriage ceremony, when it's a funeral. But sometimes, you know, the family sits and makes a decision and they are now forced to pay more than they initially would have opted to. And the reason is that they have, you know, and it's difficult for them to say, this is my working capital. If I continue to take from this, I might not be able to recover the money. So it's like the visibility leads to something else when everybody's eye on them. Okay. So we looked at this, but in In the discussions to this, I was asked by one participant whether it was bad in itself. And the reason is actually simple, and you find it in the literature. I saw Edward Clifford and Skinner and others have done work actually on what it means to accumulate capital as opposed to dissipating wealth. It appears the traditional society in which they are, you're supposed just to give handouts. You are not supposed to be making progress alone. Your progress must be seen to be, involving or including others. So it's true that they took credit, and it's true that they would want at least the working capital to stay. In which case, if they are not making enough profit, you cannot be given to people. But the understanding that the extended family and the community has is that you have, and so you should be able to help others. So in no time, you have so many pressures that they give out. Some of them is you are forced to, because some of the women narrate. I mean, they were in it, now maybe they were off for about 2 years. They are now back. And the reason why they went off was that, you have your husband who persistently saying that let's do this. You have your in-laws, sister and brother-in-laws, who constantly would come and say, can you loan me, just 10 cedis and I'll bring it back to you the next market day or tomorrow. And then it's either not paid back at all, or they stagger the payment in piecemeal that you can't do much with it. So those are the issues. And then the other one is the role of the woman in the community actually. So what I'm just saying is that traditionally, it is not like you are supposed to just be wealthy, and I'm not implying there are no wealthy people, but there are a few of them. And if you were to get near them, they will tell you how they're suffering, that every day they're knocking on their doors and they sleep very late, but they are still able to have something. So what I'm saying is that society is just like that in the Yendi area. They are thinking, in the Gbon area, that if you have prosperity, you have to share it. And if you were to share it, then you would collapse somewhere along the line, because unless you were making enough profit to be able to give that out. That is the first instance. The second is the pressure which comes that you cannot, disallow it. So it comes from very close people. They are always with you, and you live it. But also another link to the social system is also this part, that women have their rules. And the visibility we talked of means that you have to guide. Okay, thank you. You have to guide whatever you do. So it's like when you have success of some kind, your behavior has to be moderated. You have to put yourself in check or scrutiny, because if you do something, even if it's an error, they will think that it's deliberate. And so the women also said, we have problems, because if I could look my husband in the eye and say, as for this, I won't do. In my poverty, nobody would think it's a problem. But the way I dress, the way I want to be free to go to the market, do things, I interact with customers, if I want that to stay, and then I would be seen in good light, I cannot tell my husband the reality that I cannot continue to give you all this money. So basically, you have a place. And once you try to protect your working capital, is going to be understood in another way. And nobody wants that. In the interviews that I've been doing, and it's not just today, but in the last 4 years building up, you have people who said, that there's some lady who's already, who's married twice and got divorced, not because, the husband was borrowing money or anything related to this. But now she's joined that association, and she's saying that as her economic situation increases, she seems to have some additional voice. She seems to assert her rights, and sometimes she can make choices that she otherwise wouldn't. But her fear is that, how is it going to be taken? by people around, because she still wants to get a man to get married. Occasionally people just would do something or say something to her because she's single. You know, so you can imagine that kind of thing. So it's like she says, I it's like I'm making progress, but I'm not happy, you know, with this progress, because I don't know when or how people would translate this progress as what it ought to be. So the social system is so constraining that, you know, with this kind of enterprise or industry and being a role model by others, it's not the same with others as well. Others want to take advantage of you, and when you actually dare try to say that this wouldn't be the case, they interpret it differently. I have quite a number of, you know, verbatim quotes that from some of the ladies, and one particular one that I have here is from an imam who actually said, in most of his role as a religious leader, most of the counseling that he does is especially between men, husband and wife, who actually have problems and sometimes it leads to divorce, have mostly been centered on money. You know, it might not be people who are in microcredit, but men who would want to take money from their wives, and when it is not successful, they would then be able to say, then sometimes they just say, well, if this wouldn't be the case, then I disown you. You wouldn't be my wife, you know. And so you go begging, and so she says, in many instances, even my brother-in-laws, you know, they have a way of getting something from you, putting so much pressure, you know, on you to be able to give it up. So it's hearing an imam who will tell you that one of the challenges he has is actually to let men or the traditional society know that the world is changing and that women not only have rights, but in view of the contributions that they make, people shouldn't demand so much from them. So basically, I'll just try to end by looking at some conclusions. It's quite elaborate. So what I'm saying is that those involved in this rotating credit system have higher chances of getting some working capital. And a number of them, quite a significant number of them, make progress in a way. You know, they make some profit. But there are others too who would fall along the line and then they would rise again. And they fall not because they think that their business entrepreneurship didn't go very well. They fell because society brought so much pressure to them. And I'm just trying to look further into what it means, because all this poverty alleviation and reduction and the decentralization initiatives and the things that government and civil society and NGOs do is to empower people to be able to earn their own, you know, livelihoods. I think generally we agree, because in our part of the world, the institutions are weak, the social support system is weak, and if we were to rely on government to do many things, you know, then we wouldn't get started. So people in these areas who have to devise this means to go along the line, it is good that they become economically visible. Unfortunately, there are unintended outcomes which wipes it out. And I was just linking to beginning out on menstrual hygiene in Zabzugo, where there are schools that have what they call the WASH program, is what they call WINS, you know, water and sanitation in schools. And if you go to the deprived schools, and in Zabzugo, class numbers, even GSS 3, were as high as 60, 70 pupils per classroom. And that classroom is about a quarter of where we sit. You know, yeah, if you divide this into four blocks. So it's crowded. So the pupil latrine or pupil, and they call it latrines actually, they don't call it toilets. But if you even call it toilets, the pupil toilet ratio is so high that no matter the kind of interventions you make, unless you just make huge, large-scale interventions, you know, it never solves the sanitation or toilet problems. You know, it's the same thing. That was the first instance. The second instance is that the schools might have been located sometime in good compounds. Now the neighborhoods, you know, is closing up. So you don't know the boundary between the school and the neighborhood. And they told us how the neighborhood, the community would come and break open the toilet. And in fact, when they put locks there, they open it, and then they use it. When they keep the locks that they can't break, they just defecate around, as if to say, you better open this. You know. So the reality was that, you know, it's too little an initiative to be able to deal with these things. And that is why this appointment. Also, we've all been talking the progresses that we are making, and yet in some places there is very minimal progress. I was trying to look at it, but I know that Ghana's Human Development Report in 2007 dealt with social exclusion. Of course, social inclusion actually, but exclusion was the highlight, that Ghana was making progress, and I'm sure it's true today. Even as we are making economic strides, there's growing inequality too, you know. So we are not carrying everybody, and we're still not carrying a chunk of people in the development. And that is the essence of this. So this is just to show that microcredit is good. When women take it, it's innovative. We haven't even discussed the problems associated with getting credit in Ghana. Yeah, so I'm sure everybody's aware of that. And at that level, it's even harder because they have nothing as collateral. Most of them cannot read or write, and there is no way they can put something and say, take this. So it's just for this reason that we're thinking the government and development agencies need to do more, you know, by opening up. It's not like the market, the women in the rotating credit system, if they could also get some bank loan or some small money, they wouldn't take, you know, they would have taken. So if you enhance it, many more would take, and the likelihood that all the family will rely on somebody to take up their money would not be there. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you very much, Dr. Osman Alhassan. We are so grateful. We have about 20 minutes for questions, and we would take three sets of questions at each particular time. So we will take the first three questions, give the presenter the opportunity to answer those questions, and then we'll take the next set, depending on the amount of time that we have available.
Thank you very much, Dr. Alhassan. This is very exciting, but I was just wondering whether you came across any situation, rare as it may have been, where there was better cooperation between a couple because both the man and the woman had come to, you know, an equal level. In other words, the idea I'm getting here is the women are ahead of the men, but I was just wondering what happens when the woman comes up to the man or almost to the man, and then whether it affects their relationships. That's the first thing. And the second thing that I was wondering was whether you could elaborate a little bit on what the women, apart from the donations and so on, what they spend on within the family, you know, as far as children, etc., are concerned.
Thank you, Dr. Alhassan. I was wondering, these micro credit things, are they specifically targeted at women? Because I found that that was the case in the Upper West region, where microcredit and finances are particularly targeting women. And Sunsori and Denkabi found that as a result, there were as many as over 90 women's cooperative groups in the Upper West region being financed by microcredit. So is that the same case in Yendi, are they targeting women to the exclusion of men and probably now creating the situation where men feel left behind and so they want to have their share of the cake?
Thank you, Dr. Osman. My question, I think it's come up, what I'm going to say has come up in one of our conversations before, where in looking at vulnerabilities and risk profiling, we almost concluded that success then becomes a high risk factor in judging people's vulnerability and whatever. I mean, would you say it applies in this case? Is success then, in looking at the indices or whatever we want to call it, at profiling a people's risk of vulnerability, would you say that success is a key index in that kind of reasoning? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So the last one first, and it's interesting. Yet we've mentioned it in our discussions, and the reality is we use ourselves as examples. I'm sure I told the story several times, even sometimes to my students. I 7-6 years ago, I complained to my uncle, you know, in Yendi, and that's somebody I grew up with, my maternal uncle, that the guys and many other people were worrying me. And as a family head, I thought he would talk to them. Because when somebody makes a demand and say, I'm still listening to, I'm still trying to do this, they wouldn't budge, you know. And so after some time, I didn't hear from him. And I was in Yendi for about 13 days, one of my longest visits, you know. And so I went to him and said, oh, I told you this, were you able to communicate? And then he sat down and he asked me to sit down. So I knew there was something coming. I sat down and he was a malam too. In short, what he told me is that God would never give you a load to carry if he doesn't give you, you know, yeah, a strong neck. Because, you know, back home. And so that is religious. But he meant it. He told nobody anything. And then he said, I should use my, you know, whatever. When I think that is better or I can give. When I don't, I should stop. I shouldn't give. But he wouldn't tell anybody not to demand. And so, because his family believes that God has given me the shoulder or the neck to be able to carry this. So the reality is that, and we know other seniors saying, we've been saying that really, you know, that kind of thing is not sustainable. Because you never get used to it. People, new people come, old people go, new people come, and you would always do. So to some extent, yes, success is a risk factor, high risk factor. And especially so when many people are poor. That's what I think. And still holding to traditional values that, you know, I have to share with you or you have to share with me. And so, you know, it's like it's a done deal. You have no cause to complain. Once you can afford, you do that. Maybe tomorrow I could also do that. I think so. Dr. Nambigne, I'm sure you're talking of this book on challenging rural poverty. And yeah, where they found that. In fact, what we're dealing with now is the rotating credit association. And that one is amongst the women themselves. It's like a pool of resources. You pull some 2 cities, 3 cities down. Yeah, and then somebody takes it. The next time is that in the Yendi area, it's been very difficult. Even during the time of the defunct cooperative bank, you know, women have never been, and that's a good thing. I have a colleague in tech. Currently, he's doing some interviews about artisanal, you know, skills training with Cordvet in Yendi. And he was just telling me that he's surprised that he's yet to find one fitter apprentice, female, in the whole of Yendi, which is about 55,000, because he thought things were changing. And that he's seen some in Kintampo, he's seen some in even little villages as, Gosu. And he was expecting to see women that way. So I'm not sure, but there are quite a number, because you have Bonzali, rural bank. Bonzali in Dagbani simply means, savings. Or as in though, is that investment? Bonzali is more like savings. Yeah, that's savings. Thank you. So they were able to give some small credits. And these days, it goes through the assembly women. That is not very popular because many women don't get that. They gave that for soybean production. They gave that for some small rice production and maize production. And I'm aware that many men collected it. So this one is mostly men who get this microcredit through the formal system, no matter how small it is. What we're talking of right now is just the weekly, or it's not monthly. Sometimes it can be just 3 days. The regular times that the group would meet, they will contribute and one person takes it. Then the next time they rotate until it gets to the end. If you are hard up, you could then talk to somebody who would have collected before you so that you can take it. And then, you give the next chance to that person. So it's not like, men already, this is just within themselves. But once you make that progress in the house, then it becomes a problem. Now, Antesi, thank you for your question. I think there's quite something. I have in this other quantitative thing that we're doing about disaster, I have something we're documenting about flood recovery in a house. There were some floods 3 years ago, and we were just trying to look at household contributions. And this lady who constantly now, and she's not complaining, she's getting some small monies from her business, and so she just goes and buys the food for the. She has three children with the husband, but she's in a polygamous marriage. So the man has an older wife with, elder wife with five children. And so she's making financial contributions to the kids' school. She would prepare snack for them, not only hers, but as much as she can give to the others. They go to school. She includes children as well as the others, not in the same way. But in this particular instance, there was flood. And it had destroyed some burdens and some grain that they had. And she had to replenish it. So in addition to the regular things that they used to do, she had to do this. But my understanding is that if you are better off, if a funeral comes, you pay more sometimes not because you voluntarily said you can afford, but because the family decides that you should pay more. And so those were the kind of things that we saw. So they are spending that. And there are other things they're doing voluntarily. Like I said, some have even given their husbands new clothes when it's Salah time, And then the other one was whether there is some kind of harmony, Yes, I think there were few cases. And that tended to be those who are just married to, those who are not in polygamous marriages. A number of them are in polygamous marriages, and it becomes difficult in that instance, because then it means the family is, even the immediate family is bigger, for you to cope with. I would take note of that, and look at the transcriptions, but I'm sure there are few examples of that.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I wanted to ask something with regard to success. You mentioned how success can also make you vulnerable. And you mentioned something in the presentation about women who are getting access to these microcredit, and also for young women. I'm looking at it this way. I don't know if you could expand on it in developing the paper, you have called in your, you have mentioned in your recommendations that government and NGOs should open opportunities for more people to access the loans. But relating that to the status of women, whether married or unmarried, if someone is single and has more money, and how the society views the person, how the culture interprets all of that, and how that person is able to assess herself. If another person is also is married in a family, so if you're looking at just women, so we are giving more women money, we expand the opportunities for them, people will still come to them to access loans in the family, which they will not pay. So at the end of the day, even making things more successful or progressive also increases, for me, per my understanding, increases the vulnerability the most. I think that you might want to expand on that a bit more.
Maybe a bit naughty. This is where the newfound wealth of women.
Excuse me, can you be clear? I think most of us are lost. Yes, we really. No, please. For the sake of our audience, I would beg you, Dr. Nambini, to really be clear with your question. Okay, so a last question. If not, then I would ask my. All right. Ask my question, and that will be the last question. And so my question is, did you see anything about women's caregiving role and how it interplays with the challenges associated with economic visibility?
Well, thank you. And I think I'll start with Irene's first. I didn't do much about the generality of care in the household. But I do know that in some of the interviews, some of the women, where they are, and I wouldn't be surprised because there are many, Yendi, like many districts, I checked up the population, has a slight edge of females over males. Until I look clearly, I can say that girls, especially those that help in the domestic sphere, you know, that's many. But generally, many people actually have support, you know, and they have older parents or other people who are in the home, you know, doing this. What I didn't find is that once people were in rotating credit association, they found themselves some work, so they would not say they are a housewife, or they are within the house. But there are other activities like food vending that they do within the house. So they double up, you know, just doing the activity as well as, you know, caring for what they have at home. But I guess if economic visibility was anything to go by, and especially these days in Yendi too, the last time I was there, they were telling me how they, you know, health insurance is collapsing, and it's a difficult thing, and that it has a cumbersome registration procedure, and most of them don't have. So it also then means that those with relatively better resources would be able to deal with that. But having said so, there may still be men who actually would be taking care, and there would be women who might have additional load because of their visibility. But that's something I'll try to look at. I wasn't specific about care. Yeah. Sen, I know about your, I would go that way, about the coping strategies. Well, I mentioned one. So if you took my complaint to my uncle, and but I'm not one in microcredit. I think what they just do is that along the line, there are opinion leaders who would counsel them. There are some of them who eventually would, and I want to be emphatic, along the line, even as we started with some respondents, there have been some few divorces, but it's not entirely due to their economic visibility, even though it might have been part of it. So I think the coping strategy is just like I said, beyond they themselves, they cannot do much. And that ties well with what they can do is actually to try not to give. I mentioned pressure. It depends on which pressure, and it depends on who is able to absorb it. And I didn't also mention the general livelihoods model or the disaster general thing we were doing, because otherwise you are able to soak the pressure depending on who is there to support you, depending on whether those you say no would actually go and not come back. But that is why, tied to this, we are calling for government, you know, and local government intervention. In the first instance, I'm saying so because, unlike what Dr. Nambigni said, in the Yendi area, not many women have benefited from other credit systems outside, you know, this rotating credit that they are in. You know, I wouldn't know. There may be others with higher skills, more educated, who would just go to the bank as a woman and get entitled to a loan like any other person. But so what that ties up to what you said, that it's likely that when you increase the portfolio for somebody, the more trouble they would have. But my understanding is that I'm actually calling for scaling up. My understanding is that currently what is happening is their own initiative and industry. You understand? And bearing in mind that there are some other areas where other civil society organizations, NGOs, and government can step in, especially local governments, because we're talking of decentralization. You're now looking at development that is founded within grassroots. So if they expand it, there's a likelihood that many more people would get. And I just want to make a logical conclusion then that if there are more avenues, then if 20 people were to come to you, it's a likelihood that your sister or your auntie would also get some. And then it will dissipate, isn't it? So you're right that, yes, with increasing visibility, like I said, there would be unintended outcomes. And I agree with you that depending on how they judge you as being, you know, affluent, you might even get more disturbing things, you know, that than the others. And then Dr. Nambi. Yeah. Well, I didn't ask much about that. But it's obvious from spare ties. A few years ago I visited my cousin in Lome, and this is a real story. And he had been lost there for close to 7 years. Nobody in the family knew where he lived. They knew he was in Lome. I was in Accra, so they thought I had the resources and I was the proximity too. So I should look for him, you know. And so I looked for him, you know, because 5-6 years ago, that was exactly 2010. So 6 years ago, you know, mobile telephony was in hype. And then I eventually got there. And then when I got there, he received me. And so the first question I asked was, what was he doing? Because I thought he was looking fine, and no people were damn worried what he was doing. So I thought ferrying himself through Sokode and they go by the northern route to Yendi to say hello to the folks wouldn't be a big story. And so he said, oh, my madam wouldn't allow me, you know. And then later he took me, we went to greet her. It was a big market. And in Togo, they are normally in textiles, you know. Yeah, so the woman, the trader, a very wealthy trader, he was the woman's driver. But he was more the woman's boyfriend than the driver. So he doubled up as. So I think what Eddie meant was that. But and I was told, I don't have evidence, that there are some who are married and do that. I think they qualify as the spare tie then, isn't it? But there are many others who might be single, you know, or they were widowers or whatever. You know, so what he meant was this young boys who actually are friends to the sugar mummies. Yeah, I think that's what he meant. Or if you meant something different from what I said. Then.
And then they have a driver mate there.
We are so grateful. Thank you very much, Dr. Alhassan. So we are so grateful, Dr. Alhassan, for your presentation. It's been stimulating and very engaging, and we are so grateful for making time to sit through till this time. And on that note, I would hand over to Dr. Freywood.
And please excuse our technical difficulties today. So again, we had a very riveting and exciting presentation. Thank you to our chair and also to our presenter. So I just have two quick announcements and then we'll conclude. Next week, we are gonna actually have a panel discussion and the title is Black Equal African Lives Matter and Decolonizing the Academy. Prof. Adamako Mponfo will be on the panel, Dr. Kombone will be on the panel, and another doctor whose name I am forgetting at this moment will also be on the panel. So I apologize. And so that'll be an exciting presentation. So please make sure you come and tell your friends and colleagues to also come. We have one more announcement. This afternoon at 2:00 in Interrogating Africa, our host, Dr. Edema Dote, will be interviewing several women that will talk about the most recent Pan-African Women's Day activity that happened this Sunday. So please tune in 105.7 at 2 p.m. Thank you so much. See you next Thursday.